I was born in St. Louis in 1955, and I'm a fourth generation St. Louisan. My name's Gussie Clore, and I have many different identities. The first one is I'm an art therapist. My second one is that I'm a professor. I teach art therapy at SIU Edwardsville. And then my third identity is an artist. This is a guardhouse to the neighborhood. It was built in the 20s. We don't know exactly when. And it was lying unused and it was kind of falling apart. And so my husband and I approached the city and we asked them if we could renovate it in exchange for my using it as a studio. And they thought it was a great idea. The first time we came into the studio, we opened the door and it was a mess. It was full of just trash. There were dead rodents on the floor and up in the loft, like skeletal remains of, I guess, squirrels. And there were all these old documents. And the tax return from the caretaker from 1948 was sitting on the table as if he just stepped out for a minute. So the first thing we did was had to clean it out, you know, and just hauled everything out, put it out on the curb. And then once we hauled everything out, then I started saying, well, you know, there might be some good stuff in there. So then I started bringing stuff back in, but it was really hard because I wanted to renovate the place, and so you had to clean it out to renovate it, but then I'm hauling stuff back in. So I ended up saving a box of documents. It was really kind of amazing that we found some things that told a story about local history, and it was somewhat shocking at times. In particular, there was one letter that was from a private detective that was hired in the 40s to do an investigation to find out if wives and children of janitors, well, if some of the apartment buildings were living in basements because there was an ordinance against people of color living in the neighborhood. And so they hired a private investigator for $50, and I have his entire report, every apartment building that he went to and what he found. And when I held that letter, it was so hard for me to fathom because it wasn't that long ago, it was the 40s. And today on this block, this is a one block street in Clayton, and today 7 different nationalities live on this block. So the neighborhood has changed substantially. That letter was just mixed up in an envelope full of correspondence from that year. So I was just going through this envelope full of correspondence and I read that and my heart stopped. Did I read that right? And I read it again. And then I just remember thinking, I don't think anybody knows this is here. I don't think anybody even knows about this. And then I wanted to tell people, you know, I thought this is a historic document that needs to be shared. It's a moment in time that I don't know that there is any other documentation of it other than this letter. And so I think it's an important piece of our history. I was so taken by it that I started to do art about the story. And I did several pieces of art. Basically, what I wanted to do is just present facts in a different way and not put any judgment on it, but just say, this is what happened. This is a story of our neighborhood and our shared community. And it's a hard story. I don't want to bring up painful memories for people. I just wanted to get the story out there, but I also wanted to do it without putting values on it and just tell the story. Just tell the story. I know that in art therapy, a lot of times we deal with traumatic stories and people try to forget them, but those stories are still there. And telling those stories can be immensely therapeutic and helpful. And so, be it an individual story or a societal story, I think it's important to tell the story. We can't change it, but just tell the story. Although I've always put family stories in my artwork, this kind of evolution from working with the historic documents is a little bit different than what I've ever done before. And it's definitely the inspiration from the guardhouse itself, from the studio. The studio just really sparked my imagination. Mama Dillon is my great-grandmother. She came over from Ireland in the 1870s, I think, 1880s. She came from an affluent family, and she got here and discovered that the Irish were not welcome in a lot of areas. And so she had a much harder transition than she was expecting. She got married, they had 10 children, and then her husband, who was a streetcar motorman, lost his job and became an alcoholic, and the family really scraped and had a very difficult time surviving. Of the 10 children, the oldest boy helped support the family by selling newspapers, and the story is also that he would pick up coal along the railroad tracks because they had no way to heat their house. And the courts ended up taking the kids away because she wasn't supervising them and they were not going to school and running wild. So the story itself is a sad story. But the story, you know, grows, and today there's many descendants from Mama Dillon, and many prosperous families have evolved, and there's a closeness among the family that we come from. Just an important line, even though it was again, kind of a sad story, but a story. My grandmother and my great aunt both grew up at St. Mary's Orphanage. And there's a lot of stories about that. Orphanages are today not what they were back then. Very sad stories. Because they weren't really orphans, they were treated very differently than the kids that were real orphans. There was a stigma attached to the fact that they were court cases and not real orphans. So when a lice epidemic came into the orphanage, according to my grandmother, they combed the nits out of all the little girls' hairs and brushed their hair. But for the court cases, for my grandmother and my aunt, they just shaved their heads. And so they grew up really believing that they were not as good as the other kids. Another story, and I have this actually depicted in several of my pieces. They were little when they were put into the orphan home. They were 3 and 5 years old, and they still wet the bed. And so every time they wet their bed, they would have to stand on the street corner with the wet sheet over their head. I think the connective thread here is that it's all local history. It's all about St. Louis in its earlier years, and each one tells a little story about local history. There's a lot of stories in history. Some are painful, some are joyful, some are silly, but there's a lot of stories. And I think to be human, we want to tell those stories, and we want other people to hear those stories. And so that's kind of the connection that I make. I think what the art does is it adds a visual element to the story. So if you're talking about, say, the little girl with the blanket over her head, you can tell that story, but then you can also draw that image and give people just a stronger view about what would it be like to be that little three-year-old, you know? So the artwork sometimes, although I try not to put too much emotion into the artwork, it comes into the work. The emotion comes out and gets put into the work, even if you try not to let that happen. And so it does tell an emotional story. It does evoke emotions. And my hope is that people, when they see the artwork, they'll feel something. The first time I went into that history library on Skinker, I was blown away that I had never knew it existed, and it was just such a cool place, and I wanted people to know about it. So I would tell people, have you been to that history library? Have you been there? And you know, they'd look at me blankly, and I just thought this would be a great place to show the artwork. But I didn't want it to be a gallery type thing, because my artwork is meant to be touched, it's meant to be read, it's meant to be held, and so my idea was that I would hide the artwork in the history library, and then people, as they're going in to do research, would come upon the artwork and maybe would just be curious and would look at it and would experience history from a slightly different perspective. And so it was truly about kind of a seek and find. You go into the library and you go in for one thing and you find something else. That was my experience. And it's my experience every time I do research, that I go in with one idea and I come out much richer because I've had three more ideas while I've been there, and so I found more information than I bargained for, really. And so it was kind of that idea, that the History Library and Research Center is a place where people do research, and I wanted them to find stories there. I wanted the people to come to the library to be surprised by the art when they find it, but I also wanted people to come in just to see the art and then be surprised by the museum.